day 102. I just reached the summit of Yellow Gap Road. Just above 3,000 feet up here. You can still see there's probably a good 3 to 4 inches of snow left. It is raining, so it's helping it kind of melt off, but it's also making it slushy. You can hear my footfalls kind of crunching. The top layer is still a bit icy. It's just over 40 degrees right now, so hopefully we'll get some good melt off. As I drop down kind of below 3,000 feet, it's a little bit more sporadic. You'll see probably in a little bit here, it's not far in this. It's actually getting thinner as I go down here. Pretty amazing, just in a slight bit of elevation change. I guess it's also, you know, how much sun exposure it gets, but anyhow, I was feeling pretty soft. Been doing a little too much on the treadmill, and I needed to kind of change my mindset to, I get to go run outside no matter what. Talked about this earlier in my training. I wanted to kind of see how I was doing up here. Obviously, still needs a little bit of time, and hopefully between today's rain and tomorrow's rain, we'll have a good melt off. Temperatures haven't been getting as high as they forecasted. We were supposed to be up in the 50s, but it's remained in the 40s as a high. So we're still getting a little bit of melt off, but anyhow, ended up running just over 40 minutes with some of the high schoolers yesterday in the afternoon. Didn't quite get an hour. I did 2 rounds of DeSherry's hip circuit, and then I did 2 treadmill sessions yesterday, both at 18% grade for 30 minutes at 4 miles per hour. So 2 miles and about 2,100 feet of gain. So 4 miles of hiking, 4,200 feet of gain. It was a good day. 4 miles per hour kept me pretty low, you know, kind of low zone 2, hiking at 18%. So it wasn't hard, which was good. The second run was a little bit fast. Morning run was nice and easy, as I did the video yesterday, but the afternoon run with the kids was a little bit faster. So this morning, legs are feeling not fatigued, just a little sluggish. They've been feeling better as I go along here. Actually started feeling a little stronger the more I climbed. Of course, the snow and ice kind of takes a bit out of me, but anyhow, it feels good to be out. I should get about 2 hours in today. Of course, with this climb and the snow, it's not gonna be a lot of distance, probably 12 and a half ish to 13, but it's nice to do something else for a change, you know, aside from running roads and treadmill. But it does look like it needs a little bit more time up here in order to actually get some good running in. I doubt the single track's in any condition at all to run on, so stay off the single track for a bit. But like I said, nice change of pace. I was kind of thinking this morning about when I first moved here to Western North Carolina back in 2007. Things were so much simpler for running. You know, I had one pair of trail shoes. They were Adidas, and I think I had like maybe three pairs of road shoes. One was a trainer, a lightweight trainer, and then a racer. So I had four pairs of shoes. And you know, the high school kids, we were doing the hip circuits yesterday, and they're like, "You got a lot of shoes." And you know, kind of make me recognize I have been a bit excessive. You know, I totally like to try out shoes and let people know about shoes and all that, but it's also an expense. I buy them, you know, out of pocket, and that's, you know, not right. Using all the money for myself, I guess I felt a bit selfish, I guess I should say. I need to kind of change that. I've got all the gear I need for now. I've got plenty of clothes. I love my pack. The Raid Lights are doing great. I'm actually wearing it under my rain jacket right now. So something else I need to recognize and improve on is, you know, not being so selfish. Materialistic needs. I have everything I really need. I guess it does get kind of addicting. you know, having different shoes, and I just, you know, over the years, I hadn't really thought about it. You know, I have different pairs of shoes for different uses. But I guess, you know, the reality is I really don't need all those shoes. I recognize that. I don't know why it's taken me this long to think about it or recognize it, but I'm glad I had that thought this morning. Makes me feel better about, you know, who I was and who I can still be. I can make the changes and be that person I used to be. And running is, you know, it's our, I guess it's our selfish endeavor, because it is all about us. You know, it makes us better people to be around. We're happier when we run, so there's that. But, you know, I think that should be the most selfishness I have. But yeah, I also had a question come in, and it was, you know, how did I really first start getting my training philosophies? The reality was, in high school, you know, my cross country coach, who was on the first episode of my podcast, he was wonderful. You know, I can't say enough great things. He still is wonderful. I can't say enough about him and his influence on me. Really shared his passion for running. He made it fun. Really set the foundation for my career. However, he didn't coach indoor and outdoor track. We really didn't have anyone that could coach distance runners. So that fell on me to train the mid-distance and distance guys. So the question, you know, being, how did I do that? Well, yeah, I asked Coach Harnick a ton of questions, you know, about training and, you know, what principles I should follow, how often we should work out, like all that, you know, what type of workout should we be doing. I asked a lot of questions and I read anything I could get my hands on. I read, you know, magazine after magazine, just trying to understand training. There weren't a lot of books out at the time. Laura Running was there, and you know, the special person that asked the question said they had seen that book but not read it. So I mean, you know, sometimes Runner's World would put out like a little kind of booklet on training, so I would get those and read. I would ask, you know, those that I look up to in the area that I raced. I had a lot of great runners growing up, and I asked them questions about training and, you know, how do they break things down, you know, trying to understand what were cycles of training, what should I focus on, what will make me faster. So between asking tons of questions to multiple people and reading, the other part of it was just experience, training and seeing what worked, what made me faster. Just as I do, you know, kind of right now. I was, you know, just trying things and seeing, you know, does this work? How does this make me feel? You know, and my track teammates just went along with it, you know, we just trained. What are we doing today? You know, my coach, he would just say, hey, distance runners, go with Aaron. And he'd say, Aaron, what are you guys doing today? And I'd tell him what we were up to. Now, we raced a lot. Not so much in indoor. Indoor, we raced every Friday. We raced at West Point for indoor track. And we went to a few invitationals. But outdoor, we raced twice a week. Tuesdays, we'd have kind of a dual meet where it would be us versus another team or potentially a three-team meet. And then Saturdays, we'd travel to a all-day invitational where there'd be lots of teams and good competition. So that didn't leave a lot of time for, you know, actual training. You know, we kind of raced ourselves into shape a lot of the times. And, you know, all of us ran. We were only allowed to run 3 events in high school. So all of us ran 3 events to score for our team. So that would, for me, it would be mile, 2 mile, and usually 4x8. You know, the 800 meter relay. So, you know, on doing that, you know, on Tuesdays, that's 3.5 miles of racing at an intense effort. And then coming back on Saturday, you know, Saturdays I got to race a little bit more of what I wanted to, unless we were going for like a team win. You know, sometimes I would just get to run the mile or the 2 mile. But yeah, a lot of times I still had to race, you know, multiple events to again score points. So, you know, cross country, I just kind of followed along. My coach had a great plan. I trusted him, and he never let me down. Indoor and outdoor, it was a combination of everything I just talked about. And then in college, you know, I observed, and what would we do? How did we do it? I'd ask questions, and you know, I think sometimes I came off as I was questioning why we were doing it, but you know, the reality, the underlying reason was just so I would understand the principles of what we were doing. How is this making us better? just so I would learn. You know, I always envision myself as a lifelong runner. So I always wanted to make sure when I finished, you know, that I had a solid foundation and understanding of training and training principles. I guess, you know, I should have probably looked more into exercise physiology. I didn't think about it, you know, like, I didn't think about what do coaches do, you know, to get an education. I didn't think about it in that regard when I was in college. I also didn't like science much, so, but, you know, I probably should have just looked into, you know, getting an exercise physiology degree and kind of lining myself up for coaching. But, you know, these days, I just immerse myself in everything. I listen to podcasts, obviously. I read online, anything I get my hands on. I subscribe to other coaches' newsletters, kind of hear about their thoughts on training and workouts they do. I take courses, you know, from various coaching certification. Right now I'm trying to finish up my Lydiard Foundation level 3. I've taken USATF to learn about track. Taken RRCA level 1 and 2. That's the Roadrunners Club of America. I've done 2 UESCA, USCA certifications. One in running, one in ultra running. Back in the day, I actually did the endurance certification for CrossFit. That's a whole nother story I don't want to get into. Just whatever I can do. There's the scholar program by Steve Magnus. That's kind of an ongoing. So, you know, lots of stuff. There's always constant learning because there's so many ideas out there of how we can use our physiology and train ourselves to better ourselves. So there's never been, you know, one resolute, definitive, here's how you should train, because everybody's different. And that's why I try to learn so much from different sources. I mean, there's great principles and you can apply them. And I think that's, you know, what we just need to stay attuned to is, you know, what is research showing? Where is the most success coming from? So if we, you know, if we keep ourselves open-minded and, you know, and listen, we can apply these things and get better. And that's, you know, that's what I hope to do in my coaching, is just better my athletes, do what's best for them, keep them healthy, strong, running long term, and reaching their goals. So it's a bit nerve-wracking, you know, because they're putting something very important in your hands. I recognize that. You know, they've got this big goal that they, you know, they've come up with that they want to do. You know, and if they're putting the work in day in and day out, you want to see, obviously, their success as a coach. So, you know, it is. It's a bit, you know, what's going to happen? Because you're applying everything you know and doing everything you could think of to get them to that goal. And sometimes it's just the given day. You know, is the conditions right? Are they all set? You know, there's so many external factors that can disrupt it. It's just, it's so hard. But I really enjoy it. I do. I enjoy talking with my athletes, answering questions. You know, we had a great Zoom call last night with the team. Just talking about the medium long run. And then, you know, again, here I am on the medium long run. I'm going for about 2 hours. So, you know, even though I felt a little sluggish to start, these runs are just designed to add more volume to your week. You run them at an aerobic rate. So what's an aerobic rate? If you look at the 80-20 principle, it's up to 78% of your maximum heart rate. So, but depending on how you feel, I mean, you want to go under that because you're just not feeling it, that's fine. It's usually your midweek run. I just listened to the Running Rogue podcast. I think I talked about that on the video yesterday. But Chris talks about how, you know, it's kind of your, almost like a third workout. So if your long run is one workout, because you think you have to kind of take a little recovery from, and then you have some type of, let's just call it a speed session. You have to take recovery from that, and your medium long run, which obviously, you know, mine being 2 hours, I don't want to do too much tomorrow. So Chris likes to say, you know, you should have a day in between your medium long run and your other hard efforts, which I believe in as well. He adds strides to his, which is a pretty good idea. But as I explained to my athletes, if you add strides or hills, it's kind of a completely separate workout from the medium long run because you're working another system. So, but, you know, running aerobically, just has so many positive physiological gains from, you know, increasing the efficiency of the heart, to the volume of the pump that heart pumps out, to increasing mitochondrial size and density. Mitochondria are the powerhouses of our cells. It's what helps the energy cycle and gives our muscles the energy to continue running. So having more and larger mitochondria is definitely, obviously, very beneficial. So there's so many reasons, you know, why aerobic running is so beneficial. And, you know, just increasing the volume in your week, by time on feet, it's going to make you fitter. So lots of reasons to do the medium long run. When I heard that podcast, I was like, yeah, you know, I never really explained it. It's just always been part of my training regimen. When we went to college, you know, for instance, we would do 12 miles for our medium long run and like 15 for our long run. So, you know, here I'm doing 2 hours. My long run Sunday, depending on how I feel, is probably going to be somewhere between 2.5 to 3 hours. So, you know, the medium long run's not as long as the long run by any stretch, but it's longer than your average run. Be it, you know, 2 to 3 miles longer depending on how long your long run is. So for instance, if your average run was 5 miles and your long run was 10, you could do 7 to 8 miles for a medium long run. Anyhow, oh. All right, I think that's enough for today. Tomorrow, we've got a double run. So, I'll catch up with you guys tomorrow, day 103.